Hi, and welcome back to Energy Modeling Fundamentals, OpenStudio Basics. Today we're going to be, this is the third video, looking at SketchUp floor plans and building on some of the initial outlining we did in the second video in Bluebeam. So if you recall, in Bluebeam, we had a sample floor plate we were working with, and now I'm going to transition over into SketchUp and show how to turn that into a building energy massing. So if you're unfamiliar with SketchUp, I have made a previous video of just some of the basic ways to draw and navigate and move around the software, so go check that out. But right now, we're going to start in by drawing our floor plate. And just as a reference, initially we're just going to stick in drawing the actual floor plate, and then we'll move on to actually turning that into OpenStudio in a follow-up video. So here in SketchUp, what I'm going to basically do is just draw out these different sizes of the building that we know we have. So based on my measurements, I know that this was 223 feet. I can type that in and hit enter, and it starts to snap lines to these grids that SketchUp comes with. These different axes, the red axes, green and blue. So you can see here it snaps to the green axes, so I know I'm drawing now on the green line. And that's very useful because now we can see, like, if we assume, let's assume this is around number 144, we can now go this way, 144 feet. I can type that in and hit enter, and now it's made 144 feet. Jogging around our building here, again, I'll assume for this one that we do the half foot. So we're going to go in 41.5 feet. We're then going to go down 21 feet. Across, let's call this 81 feet, and then back up. For this drawing, I'm actually going to assume this. Well, let's split this line. Let's go 20 feet up, and then we'll go. What is this? 2 feet over. So we'll go. Actually, this was. If we wanted to make this consistent, this line was 21 feet. So if we made this line consistent, 21 feet. 2 feet, and then another 20 feet to start this jog. I think now, if you look even top down, that's getting pretty close. Sometimes it's easier to draw on top down, but you can start to see we're basically building out our floor plate. I'm going to go ahead and make the rest of this, starting probably from the top and going this way, and then I'll come back when I have a full floor plate. All right, so once we've drawn the floor plate, the last line you draw, so here I'll just draw this last line up here. We can see it will generate an entire closed floor polygon. And so this is what's called loose geometry inside SketchUp. It's not grouped, it's not currently in an energy model, it's just our floor plate. So what I usually recommend doing is creating the floor plate for every single level of your building. Sometimes they're all the same, sometimes they change. But let's assume this is, for now, this would be a single story building. If it was two story and the space was a little bit different, I would almost recommend modifying this one, modifying a copy of this one to represent the second floor. In energy modeling, it's very important to make sure that zones on floors above and below are somewhat aligned and somewhat cleanly stacked. It's not critical, but it does make for the least amount of errors and the least amount of trouble in a building. So we can talk about multiple story buildings later, but in other videos, I demonstrate my workflow. Basically, what I recommend doing is making this a group in SketchUp using the Move tool and making a copy of it. And this would be, again, in the instance that you have two floors, and let's say the second floor was a little different. You could now go and measure what the second floor might look like and make those modifications. And the reason I do this is because it's a lot easier now. We know that all the lines match all of those lines, and we could, if we knew that this wall was really inset by 20 feet on the second floor, you could do that. You could move this up 20 feet. And now, if we were to now draw zones and layouts, we know that when we go to stack these two floors on top of one another, everything is going to match up really, really nicely. So, now it'll all be perfect. So that's just one way I like to work, is to kind of save individual floor plans. And it helps if I'm working with someone else, because then we can discuss, is this the best layout for that floor? So we're going to keep going with our single floor for this video. And what we're going to do is we can look here on the floor plan, and at this point we are going to start to think about how we would chop this floor plan into different spaces. We can see that it has already, this is a layout we got from an architecture plan. It has some pretty good space layouts already. We see some closed offices, we see some different conference rooms, break rooms, storage rooms. So this is all very, very useful information for building out the model. A lot of times, what we really need to think about is what spaces are exposed to the facade, so that would gain solar heat gain or lose heat through conduction, and what spaces might be just floating in the middle, buffered by some other space in the building. So we can see, even though these little closed office pods are located here, here, and here, they're all in the middle of the building. And so from an energy modeling perspective, let's just draw an example, rectangle. If this is our office group here, I could almost, it doesn't matter where I put this in the energy model, because it's always going to be buffered by the perimeter. And so I could stack all these other ones, even though this space is down here and this space is over here. If I made my energy model where I just put all of these next to one another, I now could have one big block that represents the footprint of all these closed offices in my core. Maybe I include these three as well, and it makes this little shape a little bit bigger. But now this is almost, you could, in your model, we could come up with a core space that is this size. It doesn't have to be, again, that it's right where it physically is in the middle of the building, because a model, again, mostly just cares about its relationship to the outdoor exposure. So for now, we're going to come back to this floor layout in a second video, but sometimes if you have no layout at all, the simplest way is to start by making what's called a core and perimeter zoning plan. So I'm going to go ahead and explode this group I made. We don't need to make a group. But a core and perimeter zoning plan is just basically assuming that this is all, the only information we have is to define a perimeter area, which is often about 15 feet from the edge, where we know that the thermal heat gains are different, the lighting levels will be different, they may have daylighting controls. And a simple way in SketchUp is they do have this offset tool. I don't always use it, but in this case you can, where you can just click the edge, and you can then actually type in 15 feet and hit enter, and that made a line that's now inset 15 feet. In making what is again a simple core and perimeter model, we would then re I would recommend cutting all the corners so that each thermal zone that looks a certain orientation only has a wall that faces that orientation. So, for instance, if we draw these little corners, this space now only has one exterior wall. It doesn't have any bit of this wall, and it could be defined as our north zone very easily. So I'm going to go ahead and do that here for some of these other ones, so these major ones. On a space like this, I would recommend doing that. In a core and perimeter model, less is more often. So in this case, we may want to, maybe we will split this one just for now. Go here. All of these spaces is very unique. So we could decide to figure out the best way to split these. There's probably no perfect way, and this is where we might actually start to want to follow the floor plan of the building. But for now, I'm just going to break it up into a few different areas just so I have some granularity. So we have a few of these now that we're facing this way. And then you can see I have this large core space. For now, I would recommend, if you're making a core and perimeter space or model, give yourself some more functionality in the core. You may want to define some spaces as conference rooms, some spaces as unconditioned. And so sometimes what I did is I just found lines that looked like they would carry on through the model. And then maybe what I'll do is just even then split this once more. And the reason I did that is because now I have these four big rectangles that in a fast model, if we again were doing this chord perimeter model, we could just quickly say, well, I'm going to assume this is my corridors, or maybe this is my storage and elevators space. This is my open office, and you can have some more granularity. I would do this in buildings that you don't know a lot about the floor plan. In this one, we do, and we'll come back and actually figure out what the square footage is for each one of these space types and talk a little bit more about space types in the next video. But if you have just a core and perimeter shell and you only know the footprint, this type of approach, 15 feet off, works pretty well.